Good afternoon and welcome to the worship service of Victoria Congregational Church in Briarwood, Jamaica, New York. We're glad you're worshiping with us on this first Sunday of 2023, January the 1st, the first Sunday after Christmas. Today is the first Sunday, so we will be partaking of communion. You can gather your elements, your juice, your cracker, whatever you may have, and join along with us as we celebrate the Lord's Supper at the appropriate time, as we bless the bread, bless the cup, as we take, as we share Christ. Now let us join in watching the lighting of the Advent candles as we remember all the events that have led us up to this moment of the appearance of Christ. When the Magi had departed, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, "Get up, take the child and his mother and escape to Egypt. Stay there until I tell you, for Herod will soon search for the child in order to kill him." Joseph got up and during the night took the child and his mother to Egypt. He stayed there until Herod died. Then this fulfilled what the Lord has spoken through the prophet, "I have called my son out of Egypt." When Herod knew the Magi had fooled him, he grew very angry. He sent soldiers to kill all the male children in Bethlehem and in all the surrounding territory who were 2 years old and younger, according to the time that they had learned from the Magi. This fulfilled the word spoken through Jeremiah the prophet. "A voice was heard in Ramah, weeping and grieving, Rachel weeping for her children, and she did not want to be comforted because they were no more." After King Herod died, an angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt. "Get up," said the angel, "and take the child and his mother and go to the land of Israel. Those who were trying to kill the child are dead." Joseph got up, took the child and his mother and went to the land of Israel. But when he heard that Archelaus ruled over Judea in place of his father Herod, Joseph was afraid to go there. Being warned in a dream, he went to the area of Galilee. He settled in a city called Nazareth, so that what was spoken through the prophets might be fulfilled. "He will be called a Nazarene." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us join together in our opening hymn, "O Sing a Song of Bethlehem."
Thank you.
In the days that follow Christmas, the tradition of the church has been to remind us that the world never ready for Christ may react in fear and even in violence to the good news of the gospel. Matthew and the evangelist follows the story of the joy of Jesus' birth with a story of the terror of Herod's murder of the holy innocents, and sends the Holy Family away from Bethlehem as refugees. Jesus, the spotless Lamb of God, comes into our world to lead us to find home in the ways of justice, love, and peace. His birth was for his death and resurrection. His death and resurrection was for our new birth. The circle of white candles remind us of the holy innocents, of other saints and martyrs of the church who have gone before us on the way home, who share in the reign of God with us. When we think of home, we may think of a place from our childhood, a place where there is love and affection. We remember in the Christmas season that God is our home in Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us. Let us join together in a union prayer of supplication. Almighty and everlasting God, you call us to be with a cloud of witnesses who have gone before. We celebrate the communion of all people who believe in your Son, our Savior, even Jesus the Christ. Jesus, a refugee, calls us all to invite others to come home to him. Help us to share that home with those we meet every day. Help us to know that the world we live in now can be the world he wants for all of his people. May your Spirit guide us, O God, to our home in this world and in the next. We pray through the babe, the Christ, Jesus our brother. Amen. And once again, welcome this beautiful first day of January, the first day of 2023, as we worship and partake of communion together, as we celebrate together, being part of God's family, as we celebrate the presence of Christ. As we continue with worship, we shall now join with our statement of faith, which will be the affirmation of faith. Those who are able, let us please stand. You, O God, are supreme and holy. You create our world and give us life. Your purpose overarches everything we do. You have always been with us. You are God. You, O God, are infinitely generous, good beyond all measure. You came to us before we came to you. You have revealed and proved your love for us in Jesus Christ, who lived and died and rose again. You are with us now. You are God. You, O God, are Holy Spirit. You empower us to be your gospel in the world. You reconcile and heal. You overcome death. You are our God. We worship you. May the peace of Christ be with you. Let us greet one another with a sign of peace. For you at home, you can stop the video or wait till after the worship service is done and call someone up and say, I wish you the peace of Christ and good to hear your voice. Or if you're sitting beside someone, grab their hand, give them a hug or a kiss on the cheek, and just say, it's wonderful to be together here, worshiping our God, praising our Savior, and making our journey together. As we continue with the worship today, we'll be going into our first lesson of the day, which will be Isaiah chapter 63, verses 7 through 9. I recount the gracious deeds of the Lord, the praiseworthy acts of the Lord. Because of all that the Lord has done for us, and the great favor to the house of Israel, that he has shown them according to his mercy, according to the abundance of his steadfast love. For he said, Surely they are my people, children who will not deal falsely. And he became their savior in all this their distress. It was no messenger or angel, but his presence that saved them. In his love and in his pity, he redeemed them. He lifted them up and carried them all the days of old. May God's blessing be added to these words that we have heard. At this time, we have the privilege of sharing our joys and concerns. We know that this past year has led us through many different trials and tribulations, many concerns upon our hearts. We have seen healing, but we have seen death. We have seen wars, and we have seen reconciliations. We have lost loved ones, and we grieve. We have seen the birth of newborn babies, and we have witnessed the gift of life. We pray for God's blessing in this year, 2023. We pray that God's peace may prevail all over the world, and that the peace of the Christ child may invade all of the hearts and steal all the angry guns, steal the wars, and win all the wars, and that we all may come together as one through Jesus Christ, that we all may gather together as children of the Most High God. Let us now go to God in prayer. Almighty and Holy One, we come to you this day knowing that you have revealed to us the light of your Son, Jesus Christ, one who was banished from his own land to go in as a refugee into Egypt, one who has known what it is to be a stranger in a strange land, one who has been welcomed back but not to be welcomed fully by his own clan and kin. We ask you, O God, to help us to have the same strength that Christ showed and that Mary and Joseph and the rest of the family showed as they went through their trials and tribulation. May we always follow the light of Christ, not just the Bethlehem star, but the light that you gave, the true light that has entered the world, that light, Jesus Christ. Heal our hearts as we grieve for the loss of loved ones. Help us to see that there is new life and new birth. Help us as we go through this life, as we suffer pain, to know that the one who made us can heal us and bring us and make us whole once again, physically, spiritually, and emotionally. Help those that are struggling to find power in strange ways to rule over others so that they may feel bigger and stronger. Help them to see that when we find equality, this is where the most power lies. This is where strength is, together, together in your kingdom. Seize those angry guns, O Lord. Move us forward as your people. Help those civic leaders and those leaders that are appointed. Help the sovereigns and those that rule to listen to your voice, to rule with equity and justice. Help us to see the strangers and aliens in our midst, that we may provide for them and welcome them as family members. Guide us, O Lord, into your glorious future. Help us to always see that light that you have given to us, not only in this season, but in all the seasons of our life. To you we give all the praise, glory, and honor, and thanksgiving. Amen. As we continue today, we'll be going into our second lesson from Hebrews chapter 2, verses 10 through 18. It was fitting that God, for whom and through whom all things exist, in bringing many children to glory, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through suffering. For the one who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one Father. For this reason, Jesus is not ashamed to call them brothers and sisters, saying, I will proclaim your name to my brothers and sisters. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise you. And again, I will put my trust in him. again, here am I and the children whom God has given me. Since, therefore, the children share flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared the same thing, so that through death he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is, the devil, and free those who all their lives were held in slavery by the fear of death. For it is clear that he did not come to help angels, but the descendants of Abraham. Therefore, he had to become like his brothers and sisters in every respect, so that he might be merciful and faithful high priest in the service of God to make a sacrifice of atonement for the sins of the people. Because he himself was tested by what he suffered, he is able to help those who are being tested. May God's blessing and understanding be added to these words we have heard. Amen. We come to this Christmas tide as we celebrate the birth of Christ. This year, Christmas fell on a Sunday, and so we have one Sunday after Christmas, and then the following Sunday, we go right into the baptism of Christ. This following week, January 6th, we celebrate Epiphany. And Epiphany is seeing that light of Christ and realizing the star that guided the Magi. As the Magi had discovered the Christ, we discovered the Christ. And so today in the liturgical calendar, we combined a couple of things together. We have the Epiphany, and then we have some of the events of the flight into Egypt. And in all these things, we are aware that in a very short time, Mary and Joseph encountered many trials and tribulations. If they could make it through this, surely they could make it through anything. Here is Mary, a young lady, 14 or 15, found herself pregnant. Joseph is engaged to her, and Joseph wants to put her away privately, not to embarrass her, but because she's pregnant and they had no relations, he says, "This is my child," and the angels had visited both of them. And in the midst of all of this, they say, okay, Joseph goes, "I will take Mary as my wife," listens to the angel Gabriel, and the angel says, "Don't fear. That which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost, and this child is of God." And in the midst of all of these scriptures, we understand that the child will be called Emmanuel. And then upon that, these two young people have to make their way to Bethlehem because it's time for the census. Now, we know that this census was taken every so often, but everybody had to be registered in the city according to their birth. So I suppose that at this time, I was born in Pennsylvania, so if there was a registration that had to be done, I would have to make my way back to around Pittsburgh area so that I could register once again, because that's where I was born. Mary and Joseph had been born in Bethlehem. And this was quite a journey, probably at least 3 or 4 day journey. Mary, fully pregnant at this time, has to make the journey, and not in a nice car that might go smoothly over the road or in a wagon. She makes this journey by foot and on a donkey. And so Mary has a rough road ahead of her, and Joseph. Joseph is probably worried how he is going to register, take care of his wife that's pregnant and might give birth at any moment. And so they get to this town of Bethlehem where they are to be registered. And in this town, there is no place for them to stay because everybody's coming in. Everybody has to be registered. And so finally, they find a place in a stable. They find a place for Mary to bed down for a couple nights and for Joseph. I'm sure they might have paid a few dollars here or there, shekels, whatever you want to say, but they had a place out of the elements. A place at least was probably dry, and it is that on this special night, the Savior was born. Jesus was born. and there is no place to lay this child again. Where are we going to put our child? And in the midst of this, they find the feeding trough, a manger, and they put hay in it, and this is where the Savior laid. Now, we go into the story in Matthew, and the Magi are on their way. We know that it took the Magi quite some time to get to the place where Jesus was. They've been following this astronomical sign for a long time, and they go to Herod and seeking, where is this one that is to be born, the King of the Jews? Now Herod did not want to hear that there was a king coming, and so Herod don't place Chloe and say, oh, that's interesting. Let me help you. Let me ask my scholars. And so they look through the Holy Scripture and they find that the place is to be Bethlehem. And Herod goes, oh, it's good that you have found this out and found the signs of our prophets. Let me know when you find the exact place where this baby is. Now these Magi, these wise individuals, knew better than to tell Herod again. So they came in one way, they found Jesus in Bethlehem. Now by that time, maybe they had found more room in the inn because part of the census had been done. We know that there was a decree that went out from Herod that all male children 2 years and younger would be killed because there was no certain timeline that Herod knew that the child was born. And the Magi went back another way after they had given the gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And Mary and Joseph find out that they have to flee the country and go somewhere else because they will be killed. Now, they were refugees. They had to go to Egypt. And they were in a land that was not their own, a land, though, that somehow welcomed them. We sometimes find it in our hearts to throw away the refugee, to neglect the refugee, to say, you have no place here. Even though your country is dangerous, don't take my money, don't take my place, I don't want to share with you. And we are confronted with, if Jesus and Joseph and Mary had been sent to the United States, would we have welcomed them with open arms? Or we have welcomed them because they were from the Middle East and said, no, they're terrorists, we can't have them in our country? We have to be confronted with some of our prejudices and how we think at times. And these stories around this Christmas tide are confronting us to be the people of God, to help us to be ready to accept the Savior, ready to accept salvation, ready to accept and be part of God's kingdom. And so here is his family in Egypt, and they have to stay there. And finally, an angel comes and says, the situation is better. Now, maybe today they'd be watching CNN, Fox News, something on television, or maybe they had a cell phone and say, oh, look here now, it's safe to go. Herod passed away a month ago. Now we can go back. And it was that Mary and Joseph went back, but they knew that Herod's son, Archelaus, now was ruler and hoped to avoid any more conflict. So they went on to the place called Nazareth. And this is where they lived and dwelled. And Joseph was a carpenter, and so he made his living. And the family was there for a while. We know that the family stayed in Nazareth even through the growth spurts of Jesus. They made their way to the temple. I would probably call it a bar mitzvah, but when Jesus was old enough, they took to the temple and they couldn't find him when Mary and Joseph went to go back home. And he looks at, and Jesus says, didn't you know I'd be about my father's business? Talking with the leaders of the synagogue, talking with the priests and the elders, finding out and asking and learning and communion in the sense of speaking with one another. Now, in these stories, we sometimes don't like to confront our own prejudices. We don't like to confront how we would welcome
a babe that was not ours. We do not like the fact sometimes that we feel we don't have enough. Why should we help someone else out? But it is in our scripture lessons today that we find we all go through trials and tribulations. And then the writer of Hebrews tells us very specifically, God chose to send the only begotten Son as a human, not as an angel, not as a cow, not as a donkey, but Jesus, his very flesh and blood and bones of the one who created us, became human. And Jesus was fully human and fully divine. He shared with us our common lot. Jesus came and walked with us and knew what it was to have adversity, knew and looked around and said, diversity is good. God has come to save all the world, not just some of the world, as the Gospel of John tells us. For God so loved the world, not just my little part. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And we just want to say, God came for some of us, not all of us. And shame on you for not believing the gospel message, for not believing the proclamation of the angels. For us is born this day a Savior that will save all people. Shame on us for not opening our ears and opening our hearts to God's message. Shame on us for not seeing the light and letting the light permeate our life. Are there people that don't believe? Yes, there are. But there are people that believe, and just because they don't believe the exact same way we believe, we alienate them. There's something that we must do in our hearts to overcome our own prejudices. It's the only way that we can welcome this stranger and the foreigner. Welcome those that are alienated. Welcome those who are refugees from other places that have no safety, that have to find comfort in the arms of strangers. It is in these places that we have to find that when we prepare a field and grow a crop, we don't take the whole crop. We leave stuff on the edges so that those aliens may glean from the field and may find food and may find grace and may find something that will help them to move forward. It is what we would hope for ourselves. It's what I pray that we find in ourselves, the grace of God. We find in ourselves that light of Christ that shines so brightly. May it never dim. May we always follow that light. And may God always bring us safely together into one big family and body. Amen and amen. God calls us to give. God calls us to be cheerful givers. We give not just for ourselves, but we give to increase God's kingdom. We give to share God's blessing. For you at home, there is an address on the screen. You may give to the ministry here at Victoria Congregational Church. You may give to help us to feed those that are in need of food with our free Briarwood community meal. Or if you have a local charity, a local church, please sponsor them also. Help them and share in the increase of God's kingdom. Thank you. Join with me in the prayer of dedication. With these gifts, dear God, accept the praise and thanksgiving of our hearts, which rejoice in your goodness and love. Let our hearts point to your presence in the world and do your transforming work among all who are vulnerable and in need. Amen. As is our privilege on the first of the month and many times when we gather, we now today gather to celebrate the Lord's Supper, communion together. In preparing for that time, we'll be singing, "It Came Upon the Midnight Clear." Let us celebrate that Christ is alive and in our midst. Shall we pray? As the Magi beheld the child in Bethlehem, we behold the man on the cross, his body and blood given and shed for our sins. Strengthen you in your journey of faith. Go forth into the night, wrapped in God's love, singing praises. The light shines in the darkness. Celebrate the birth of our Savior. Amen. Let us continue to pray as our Son, as our Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The bread that we break, is it not a sharing in the body of Christ? Amen. The cup of thanksgiving which we give thanks, is it not a sharing in the blood of Christ? Amen. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. For us in the congregation, we have the communion cups. We'll take off the cellophane layer to reveal the bread. For you at home, please take along with us. Take and receive the body of Christ given for us. And then we in the congregation, we reveal the juice, the blessing of God, This is the cup of blessing given for us. Drink from it, all of you. Let us share together the prayer of thanksgiving. We give you thanks, O God, that you have come to us through Jesus Christ, both in the midst of time and history in the city of Bethlehem, and in the timeless presence of Christ's Spirit, as we receive the gifts of bread and wine. Send us into the world rejoicing, ready to share your love with the people we meet. Through the grace of Jesus Christ. Amen. As we close out today's service, we'll be singing the hymn, What Child Is This?, and then receive the benediction. Let us go forth with eyes to see and ears to hear and voices to proclaim in the work of justice, Christ, in the practice of mercy, Christ, in the good news for the poor, Christ, in the vision of peace, Christ. Amen. Thanks be to God.